I have three kids, and if you have kids, you are probably familiar with this experience. I came home the other day and found some artwork, some unsolicited artwork. I think it was behind a door or back in the corner of the house somewhere. Actually, I think it was in a closet. Yeah, someone had taken a Sharpie and scribbled all over the walls in the back of a closet. And this was obviously some of the artist's earlier work, not a current piece. It was lower to the ground, and it looked more like the work of a two-year-old, and my youngest at the time was five. So I knew that this has had to have happened years earlier, and I guess because it was in the back of this closet, I didn't see it for a couple of years. And normally this kind of thing would infuriate me, but what was funny is it actually didn't infuriate me. It kind of made me tear up a little bit because I realized I was looking into a window of the past. And it's kind of funny how at one point in time, a thing that infuriates you is precious at another stage in life. You know, I was witnessing something sacred, the evidence of this beautiful life. And I felt like I was paying respect to the evidence of one of the most significant things that would ever happen to me in viewing this piece of work. The way I see it, you sacrifice your youth for children. You take your youth and you lay it down on the altar and give it up for your children. Women especially do this, but men do too. We transfer our youth and any leftover childish dream or energy, and we transfer it to them. We either choose to do this for our children or they take it from us. You know, things you didn't realize you love so much, like sleep, like a car that doesn't reek, like bathroom walls and floors that are not stained with pee, vacations that are actually relaxing, like days off that aren't more exhausting than work, like going to the movies for less than $100. You know, over time, so much of you that was young and vibrant and alive slowly fades and is laid upon the altar of t-ball practice, science projects, emergency room visits, hurt feelings, parent-teacher conferences, summer camps, tantrums, and every sort of meltdown, collapse, and public display. Some days I can hear the screaming from the street when I get home from work, and I die a little with every step I take toward the bloodbath that awaits me. When you have kids, a thing in you dies. You give all the youngness you had left to them, and in a way, you die too. But it's this way with all good things. There is a sacrifice that stands between you and everything good. See, children take your old, used up, faded glory and they kill it. But in return, they give you something else. They take your dying youth and give you a chance to experience a new childhood, not just your inflated memories of some forgotten glory days, but a glorious new youth. They kill you, but they give you a new life. They give you the opportunity to enjoy all the things that you and your smug sophistication forgot that you loved. They give you snakes and horses and trampolines. They give you Mario and Saturday cartoons. They give you dogs and bicycles and nature shows. They give you costumes, forts, trains, and airplanes, paper mache, comic books, Harry Potter, Star Wars, and Dr. Seuss. When everyone else passes a cow or a horse as though it was just a tree or a rock, you get to stop and glory again in their majesty. And then you get to glory in the rock and the tree too. Because your sad, glazed, over-practical, numb-to-beauty eyes have been torn open again by creatures who still recognize the transcendence and things that we have mistakenly grown to consider common. They find a galaxy of meaning in a duck, a frog, or a baseball. In this way, children literally see the world better and more accurately than we do. They teach us a new way to see the world, ourselves, and God. So Magic Mirror is a song about my kids, about how I feel like they make me see myself and God and the world in a different way. And during the original recording, Gabe, who also has five kids. His kids are about the same age as my kids. And so we were thinking about this concept, and he wanted this sort of childish elements, you know, to kind of hang around the background. There's this drum that's way out. He wanted it to sound like a monkey or a kid just playing a drum. You know, there are these weird sounds. And there's one point, you know, after the line, the writing on my walls, it's orange and pink and blue. You hear this noise in the background. It's actually Gabe screaming as though he came home and found the artwork on his walls. And we didn't know he was going to do it. We were just sitting around talking, and out of nowhere, he screamed so loud, and we thought something was wrong. We turned around and looked at him. He's like, hang on, guys, and he dropped it. So in the original version of the song, right after that line, you can hear Gabe screaming at us.